Good morning and welcome to this week's edition of NCompass Live. Just like last week, I am not Krista Burns. I am your guest host this week, Michael Sauers, the Technology Innovation Librarian here at the Nebraska Library Commission. NCompass Live is our weekly online webinar in which we talk about things of interest to Nebraska librarians and to anyone else who is welcome to sign on in and take a listen with us. We talk about topics from technology to fundraising to programming to whatever we can come up with, and any and all suggestions for future episodes are completely welcome. Once a month, I do a tech talk here on NCompass Live and try to get people who I think are very interesting and doing interesting things in the world of librarianship. In the realm of technology. So we tend to get a little more geeky in this particular episode. And lately we've been having some presentations and things like that, and I wanted to try to get back to the interview format a little more. So this month, this week, today, we have on the line Sarah Houghton. Sarah, are you there?
I am here.
Yay, all right. I'm gonna pull up your website in just a minute here, but what I think I'd like to do, just so I make sure I don't put any words in your mouth, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, how you got into libraries, and where you are now?
Wow, okay. that's a lot. So right now I am the acting director at the San Rafael Public Library. I was assistant director, and then my director kind of jettisoned a while ago, so it's been about 3 weeks of me in the director's chair, and my reaction at the time was, are you sure you guys want to put me in charge of the library? But it's been fun. It's been an experience. Before that, I've had technology positions all over the San Francisco Bay Area, working in libraries. I've run this website, the Librarian and Black Blog, for 8 years. This month, which is a little bit frightening, and it makes me feel really old because it doesn't seem like it's been that long. every now and again, I'll get somebody saying that they studied my blog in library school, and that really makes me feel old. Let's see, how did I get into libraries? I was pursuing a master's degree in ancient Irish mythology and literature, which has all of like 4 jobs in the world available to people with that degree. And I liked the topics, but I didn't really like working in academia. I felt like what I was doing wasn't really making a big difference every day. Like, I wasn't really helping people with my work. But I'd been, as many of us had been, you know, working in libraries to put myself through school, and realized that was what I did like doing, was I felt like in the library setting I was actually helping people. And so I decided to go to library school. But again, I didn't really go toward the techie side of things. I was focusing on rare books and digitization, and that kind of accidentally led to this whole techie existence. So that's it.
Great. Well, I've got to say, at a conference a year or so ago, I think I not intentionally figured out your age, and you made me feel old. So, you know, we all have our stages where we start to figure that one out. So, okay, let's ask the question, why Librarian in Black? Just for people who don't know you, who haven't met you, why?
I just wear black. That's the easy question. That's the easy answer. That's it. I mean, I had nothing but black for quite a long time now. And, you know, looking for a blog title, this is what people always referred to me at the reference desk. Patrons would come in and say, where's that Librarian in Black? You know, where's that tall librarian girl who always wears black? And so I just thought that was a fitting title.
Hey, no, that works. And that's the part of the story I didn't know, was the reference desk. That's great. Okay, the reason I kind of have you on the line here is you have opinions for anybody who has read your blog and that. But before we get into some of those opinions, one of the things I like to ask people that I know that are very big in social media, as you are, is your kind of thoughts and views on the question about separating your personal life from your work life. I know your blog is not completely work-related, but it's not completely personal either. It's kind of a mix. How do you see that sort of issue, and where do you come down on it?
Yeah, I think it's kind of been a journey for me. I think I started in one place and have ended up somewhere else. The blog is like, I would say like 99% work-related. So the blog really does pretty much stay focused on libraries for the most part, or I at least pretend that I can tie something back to libraries. Like I've been doing gadget posts, and you know, a lot of what I'm writing about could be used in a library, except for the kitchen stuff. But you know, I try to keep that work focused, but my existence everywhere else, whether it's Twitter or Facebook or Google Plus or gosh, back in the day, the good old MySpace. I think I've journeyed from somewhere where I tried to keep it solely work-oriented to a completely and entirely blended existence. In my head, I can't separate who I am as librarian Sarah from who I am during every other hour of the day. It's just one person. And I think to try to draw a line between the two would be pretty false. That being said, there are quite a few things that I find myself writing down and, you know, typing out to tweet, and then I catch myself and I'm like, wait, okay, remember, everybody sees this. Okay, maybe not so much, so then I'll just take it back. But I definitely write about both, and I think the few people I know who have tried to draw that line between personal and professional and to create two separate existences in social media or just one or the other, they've all given up. So that's a good sign to me that maybe that just can't work, really, or at least it can't work very well.
Yeah, that's been my experience, too, that, you know, again, the few people who have tried, it's almost sometimes more work than it's worth. But you do have to be aware of what you say, what you do, and put it out there. I've had the conversation with folks that say, well, a future employer might look at this. And I'm cognizant of that, but to a certain extent, and it's easier to say maybe than to actually have happen, but if they don't want to hire me because of what I put on my blog, I probably don't want to work there.
Exactly. I agree. This last job as assistant director, I think I got in large part because of my blogging. And because the person who hired me had both worked with me, but he knew exactly what he was getting. And, you know, I said, you know, I'm going to write about stuff that's probably going to make you mad and it might get me in trouble. And, you know, that's happening, right? And he said, of course, that's why I want you to work here. So that's the kind of job you want. Yeah.
Yeah. Now they want you to run the place.
Well, we'll see.
Well, I didn't say you want to run the place. It sounds like at least temporarily they want you to run the place. So that's
yeah, temporarily I am. I am doing my best.
Let's dive right into it. You seem to be taking some umbrage or having some issues with the state of ebooks. And libraries. This is a whole ball of wax here, so I want to see if we can maybe focus the conversation a little bit. But let's ignore vendors for a moment. What sort of issues do you have with ebooks as they are in general?
As they are in general, I think like many people, I'm concerned about standard formats. Uh-huh. And the lack of cross-compatibility between formats and between devices. And a lot of that with the formats goes back to digital rights management, which is, I think, my biggest concern as a librarian and as a reader, as a book consumer. It bothers me that we've got all of this content that we're paying for that is locked down with keys that we don't own. Someone else has the key, and they just give us temporary use of it from time to time to unlock something. And I think looking at the library's role as a long-term preservation entity of the cultural record, of our community's interests of information, that is extraordinarily damaged by having content that's locked down with digital rights management. And I'm very concerned, and I think that either the role of libraries is going to completely shift away from being this, you know, preserver of information in the cultural record, and I think that is one possible outcome, or we're basically backing ourselves into a corner where we're still saying, yes, that's our role. But as we put more and more resources into digital information and more resources are released solely as digital information, we won't be able to fulfill that role. And then we become, in some ways, at least in that role in our community, obsolete. And that is very concerning to me. And I think we have not been very cautious about this or mindful of it as we've delved into the world of digital information.
Yeah, I think you touched on the thing with the keys there. I think it's now known as a Doctorow's first law after Cory Doctorow, something along the lines of anytime somebody puts a lock on something of yours and doesn't give you the key is not doing it in your interest.
Correct, right.
Something to that effect. And I just had another question. I completely lost it, so maybe I'll...
Well, that's all right.
Something you said... okay. Well, I lost it. All right. So what do you make of there was Google attempting to kind of scan everything. There's now, is it the Internet Archive that's doing the, you send us a book, we'll scan it, but then we'll keep the book,
right.
And you'll have access to it. What do you think of that sort of arrangement? With what they're trying to do, and I mean, I'm obviously not asking for a legal opinion here, but it is a different take on it.
It is. I mean, I think one of the things I'm most interested in with what the Internet Archive is doing is that, you know, they're really pushing those legal boundaries of taking a physical entity, taking a physical book that's been donated or discarded from a library, scanning a copy in. And granted, you know, these are all things that are orphan works or out of copyright or in some gray area. And then they're making that digital copy available to all member libraries. And so because they're transitioning from one medium to the other, you know, that could be viewed very easily as a violation of copyright if you want to read straight by the letter of the law. So I'm really interested to see if that takes us in a good direction. What I like about what they're doing is that it's all completely open. You know, everything's open source. You can basically make a copy of their entire database with all the books in it and the technology that runs it on the back end and run one of your own if you really want to. And I think that open approach is the future to preserving and sharing information, at least from a librarian's perspective. I think that's really essential.
Okay. I have forgotten to mention, I'll say this here to anybody listening, if you have any questions for Sarah about anything we're talking about, just go ahead and type them into the questions area in the GoToWebinar interface. I'll see those and happily pass those questions along. Okay, let's get a little more specific. When Kindle books – oh, I remembered my other question. Okay. What, and this is one of those, it almost sounds like a library school exam question. What is the responsibility to the patrons from the library when it comes to these issues? Or you kind of mentioned your impression was kind of we're rushing in to this content, which is locked and maybe we won't have it long term, things like that. But it's something the patrons want. Okay, you can't argue there isn't a demand. So what is it to the library's responsive? What level of responsibility does the library have to either on one hand offer it because that's what they want, or maybe on the other end of the scale saying we're not going to give you this to you because the deal's no good and we're looking out for your interests.
Well, I think there's maybe somewhere in between those two. I think what we're struggling with is patrons are saying, we want this, we want this, we want this. And we say, okay, you want this whole world of ebooks, all the ebooks out there. We'd love to give that to you, so we're going to try. And we can't because there, as you know, are companies and publishers that won't even sell to libraries. So we can't even get Simon & Schuster or Macmillan ebooks at all, period. Nothing. And so we can't even give people what they want, in truth. We can give them a limited subset of what they want. You've also got the question of, is it a good investment of money? Are you getting a good return on investment for these titles? And I think that's a question we don't really have an answer to yet. I know that doing my own cost comparisons on a cost per circulation basis, ebooks are a better deal than print books in most cases. However, and that's a big however, with print books, you actually own the thing. You get to keep it. And with all of our digital content, we're only licensing access to it. That's it. You know, we don't own this stuff. We're licensing access. And whether or not that affects your overall view of return on investment, I think it should. And so that's a question is, you know, are you really expending your taxpayer dollars or your student dollars as well as you could be when you're purchasing digital content or licensing digital content, I should say, paying money for digital content. And then you're really, you know, stuck with this whole thing of how does the system work and does it really match up with the ethics that we hold dear in libraries, which is, you know, free and open access to information, no discrimination based on age or based on, you know, proficiency, you know, making sure that this information is accessible long term. And I think that's an area where it's a little sketchy. You know, we've got, in my mind, some severe changes to the way that user data is handled with particularly the Kindle books in OverDrive, and that makes it very tricky for us because we can either say, well, we think this is a bad deal, so we're not going to offer it, or here it is, just take it. We're not even going to bother. We know you people don't care, and you're not going to read anything we write anyway. Or you can take kind of the middle ground and actually inform your users about what they're getting themselves into. So, for example, the Wisconsin libraries had that lovely little pop-up warning in OverDrive where if you're trying to check out a Kindle book, you get this little pop-up that says, oh, by the way, you're leaving the library's site. Amazon might, you know, track what you're reading on Kindle, blah, 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 blah. And we just put that in our catalog as well, The same pop-up. And I think that's the kind of thing that's responsible for us to do as library professionals is to let people make an informed choice, to give them the information, and if they want to decide, it doesn't matter to me. This is fine. It's a trade-off I'm willing to make. At least we've helped them make an educated choice rather than, you know, not giving them that information.
Sure. Let me just for fun, push back on a little bit on that. Haven't we kind of, though, already had the ownership versus licensing argument when we moved all of our a good portion of our reference materials to licensed databases? What makes this any different?
Well, I think that's a good question, and I think I could argue either side. What makes it different in my head is that with the reference titles or the periodicals that we moved away from owning physical copies of to licensing annual access to, for the most part, those titles were a periodically issued thing. They rotated in and out. You know, you'd get an edition and then you'd buy a new edition a few years later, or periodicals. Most libraries, with the exception of really large universities, didn't keep all the back issues forever and ever and ever. You know, you just kept a certain amount of stuff and you really didn't have it anyway. I guess what I'm saying, there was no long-term preservation issue. With books, in all types of libraries, public, school, academic, special, we tend to hold on to those more. You know, we tend to actually keep those for a much, much longer time than we did with reference works or with periodicals. And so for me now, there is an issue of long-term preservation because that is something that we have been doing for a long time and that in many cases the community has come to expect from us. So to me, that's the difference, but I can see arguing both sides of that.
Oh, actually, that's probably the best answer to the difference I've ever heard, actually.
Yay!
It was one of those issues where it was kind of sitting in the back of my mind, but I hadn't really sat back and thought about it yet. And actually, I think, and yeah, it is one of those things where you can, if you understand the issues, you can probably argue both sides of it, but ultimately you do have to make, you need to come down in one direction or the other, ultimately. So when I first thought you would make a really great guest is when the books for Kindle, the ebooks for Kindle finally happened. back in, well, that was about October, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And yay, glory, hallelujah, everybody who owns a Kindle, who then walked into the library and said, I just got a Kindle for my birthday. Can I get library books? We all had to say no. We can now say, yes, you can, and everybody was happy. And then I started reading some blog posts where not everybody was happy, and you were one of them. What was the deal there? What aren't you happy about when it comes to Kindle via OverDrive in library books?
Well, I think there's two primary things that make me upset, and I'll start with the little one. The little one is that users are pushed to buy the book twice when they decide to check something out. So when the book is due in a couple of days, they get a little email saying, you know, your book is going to expire soon from the library. Why don't you buy a copy? And I mean, and it's very not subtle. It's and then it's like, or you can check it out again from the library. You know, it's almost like this little footnote, like, oh yeah, you could still get it for free, but don't you want to buy it from us? And that commercialism really bothers me. And they get the same email again when the book does expire. And I know in our library, we're not allowed to endorse or promote any particular company or business or product. It's very, very, very strict. And I feel like this email really walks that line of, it kind of seems like we are, you know, we're offering a service that generates an email that encourages people to buy something from Amazon. And that makes me uncomfortable because it puts the library at risk. And I don't think that libraries as civic institutions should be engaged in that kind of behavior. And the fact that that happens and that it wasn't something that, you know, libraries were able to say, yes, we're fine with that. Thank you for warning us that this was going to happen. We can choose to either do it or not. Great. It just kind of started, and then we all discovered this stuff after the launch, and that bothered me. The second and bigger thing for me, though, is what I had touched on earlier, which is the way that this works with Kindle, with Amazon, is different than the way that eBooks through OverDrive or any other vendor work with any other device. And so for the first time, you're not just downloading it through OverDrive, you're getting punted off to Amazon's site, and Amazon is now keeping a record of any of the Kindle format books that you check out from your library through your Amazon account, because you have to tie the Amazon account to the library account. And that distresses me, because as far as I can figure, and if someone knows otherwise, please tell me, it seems like this is the first time in the history of libraries where a corporation is tracking a user's borrowing history just kind of like out of the gate. They know exactly what's going on. They're tracking it. They won't talk to us. They won't tell us exactly what they are or aren't tracking. And so we don't really have really good information to give to people about what's being checked. I think people expect libraries to be a place where they can borrow things, look at things, read things without being tracked. I think that's the expectation. If they decide to give that up, to trade that away, so some people will turn on like a reading history feature or something in their account, then they can make that choice actively. But I think the default is people still expect this to be an anonymous and non-tracked experience. And it really irks me that the way that this was done was really, truly, without any honest discussion with libraries ahead of time, without warning us ahead of time, without preparing us or giving us talking points or even giving us clear explanations of what was being done. It was just like, look, Kindle books, maybe if we distract you with this awesome shiny thing that you guys have been asking for, you won't notice all this crap we had to trade away, like your ethics and your values and whatnot. And that bothers me as a corporate practice, and I really hope that other companies and publishers don't follow suit.
Okay. You know, as you were talking, watching me move off screen here, I'm making little notes so I don't forget my questions. So what it, now, pending the any sort of rules or regulations against promoting a particular product, it's a completely legitimate issue, I would say. What if we were able to, for example, be an Amazon associate at the library and get a cut of those sales? How would you feel about that if they were able to set that up, and assuming your municipality would allow you to do that, what would you think of something like that?
Our municipality would not allow us to do that, but okay. Let's see. How would I feel about it? Well, it would be better than nothing. I still don't like it as much. And I think if it was going to be presented that way, you would definitely want to emphasize, you know, you can still get this for free through the library. This is the way you initially chose to interact with this content. Here's a way to keep doing that. If you don't want to wait in the hold list again or, you know, whatever, then here's a way to buy it and the library will get a little something something. I guess I'd much rather...
Kind of flip the order of what's being presented.
Yeah, flip the emphasis, but... I still think it would. I still don't think that it would sit well with me personally, but that's
fair,
just me.
Fair enough. And then on the tracking issue, aren't theoretically the kind of going back to that database vendors thing, aren't those vendors able to track what articles I've gone through and what searches I've done through EBSCO, Wilson, whoever? I'm not picking on any vendor in particular.
Are they able to?
Well, or are they?
Well, they say they're not. They say all the data is being examined in aggregate, and I take them at their word if that's what they say they're doing. Could they? Yeah, they could.
Okay.
They could, but you know.
Your argument is that we have no statement from Amazon saying they're not.
In fact, we kind of realize that they are.
All right.
If you start, you know, looking at the information that's being sent to them, there's a lot kind of going on in the background between OverDrive and Amazon that's just not public information and not information that we as customers are legally or rightfully privy to. But I'm hopeful that we'll get a little bit more transparency if we keep pushing. I just feel like OverDrive passes the buck on Amazon and says, we'll ask them, but Amazon won't talk to us at all. And so we're left with nothing. We're left not knowing what the privacy violations are or are not with a product that we're pushing to patrons. And that's an unacceptable professional sacrifice. I'm not willing to do that.
Sure. And you just said the magic word that I also wrote down, which it sounds like ultimately one of your largest issues is an issue of transparency.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think I understand all of these companies are trying to make money. That's great. And if they can make money providing us with services that work with our users, better yet, you know, bully for them for working with libraries and with all of us. That's wonderful. But doing so with secret deals behind closed doors that they can't reveal the terms of puts us in an awkward position where we're being asked to trust. And there's no real basis for that trust. And I feel very uncomfortable promoting things to customers when I don't really understand what it is I'm promoting and what I might be trading away of their privacy or their data or their level of service with any product. And really, I mean, I truly do not mean to pick on OverDrive. This is something that I think we need to watch all the ebook vendors on, all of our digital content providers on, period.
Mm-hmm. And just because probably a question I should have asked before we started this line, does your library offer OverDrive content? Are you a subscriber to OverDrive?
We are. We're a subscriber through our consortium.
Okay.
And I'll just put it this way, if we weren't part of a consortium and we were just San Rafael Public Library, what we would be offering right now would be 100% different than what we're offering right now.
Okay, fair enough. What do you envision you would be offering?
I would not be offering any ebooks that I could not buy the rights to outright. I wouldn't be offering anything I had to subscribe to. I wouldn't be offering anything I had to pay an annual platform fee to keep the privilege for accessing. I would only be offering as much as I could free open access titles, open, you know, things in formats that'll work on anybody's device so that we're not privileging devices one over the other. Basically, probably I wouldn't be subscribing to any of the popular ebook content that's out there right now. I'd be promoting what's out there for free, and I'd be explaining to people why we were doing that.
Okay.
But I know that that's like a hardcore stance, and it would be very difficult. I do know libraries that are doing this, though, you know, and I think it would be something I'd have to be very comfortable defending publicly, and I would be, but again, we are part of this larger countywide consortium, and we're one vote out of seven. So we do what we can.
Hey, you know, in hardcore stances, that's why I've got you on the call. Okay, staying with the ebooks for just a little longer, there was a kind of second brouhaha a little more recently, which as far as I could tell, you sort of broke in a journalistic term, dealing with Overdrive and what material was available to which libraries. So I was wondering if you could just kind of fill us in on what got your ire up there.
Yeah, well, actually, Ryan Claringbull broke the story, and I just noticed that he's actually on today. He's on the attendee list. So, hi, Ryan.
Oh. Ryan, if you got something to say, raise your hand, and I can turn on your microphone. But we'll give Sarah a chance here to go from there. If you want to clarify anything, just let me know.
Yeah, I'd love to hear from Ryan. Basically, Ryan popped me an email that basically said, like, you know, I'm noticing something weird in our catalog of materials that we can order from Overdrive, and it seems like we have a subset of materials because nearby libraries have books that we don't even see as an option for us to pay for. So I'm confused, and he said something like, oh, you probably know all about this, and it's, you know, just tell me what's going on. I'm really, really confused. And my first thought was, oh, it's probably just a glitch in the Overdrive catalog today, or there's some weird thing going on with their database of materials for selection. I don't know. But that's weird. And I said, I really don't know about this, and I don't think anybody knows about this. And so Ryan and I started spot-checking titles between his catalog and mine, and then also between other libraries that I was able to rope in anonymously because they were all scared to come out publicly. But just looking at what he had versus what we had, and it really became clear that his library was not given the same catalog of materials to select from through Overdrive as my library was, or other libraries were. And, you know, there was a reason for that in the contract. If you really look carefully at the contract language, he had a clause in his libraries that mine did not in ours. But Overdrive was not upfront about that with their library, did not say, oh, because you happen to provide library cards to people outside of your technical political jurisdiction, you're going to get a substandard crappy catalog of stuff to select from. Ha ha ha, all the bestsellers? No, you don't get to have those. That was never told to them. And so I think, again, this lack of transparency and this kind of, well, let's see what we can get away with and hopefully nobody will notice. And that bothers me a lot. And I just, again, big props to Ryan for noticing and big props to Ryan for reaching out and trying to figure out what was going on.
Ryan, I was just talking to him in the chat. His microphone is broken at the moment, so he won't be joining us via audio. But if it was trying to figure out how to phrase my question, I guess, and again, just to kind of, you know, push back a little bit, if it was in the contract that, and I have not read the contracts, so, but if it was in the contract that this was the case, is that not enough notice? I guess, what more did you want from Overdrive? I guess I'm hesitant to assign some malice or you know the evil laugh sort of thing. Right. We're going to get away with this.
Well, if you want to scroll down on my website, you can actually go to the post, and the contract language is in the post.
Right here.
Yeah, if you just scroll down a little bit more, a little further down, he's got the contract language pulled out. There it is. The access to application services, blah 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 blah. That is the clause that basically states they could do what they did. Now, when I read that, I don't read that and see anywhere in there it's saying, oh yeah, and by the by, we're going to be giving you a substandard catalog of materials to select from. And I definitely think that the fact that Overdrive gets to decide, you know, what a quote-unquote library service area is, which they don't define in the contract, but they get to just decide what it means. The library doesn't decide what your service area is. They do. That's distressing. You know, to me, there's if you know the issue and you go back to the contract trying to find a reason why they could do what they said, this is it. But if you're just reading the contract, there's no way that you would read this and then assume that what happened to that library is what was going to happen.
Now, and I assume you're not going to like this, but as I recall, Overdrive's response was, and Ryan has commented that it was they don't define what library service area is in the contract, so that was unclear. Overdrive's response was that if you provide outside of what is defined as the service area. So just to clarify, for example, for those listening, if you're not familiar with this, for example, I don't live in Omaha, but I do have borrowing privileges in Omaha. So that might be a case in which they would say I'm outside Omaha's traditional service area. Now, I'm not saying this actually happens in Omaha versus Lincoln, but that would be the sort of example we're talking about. Correct me if I'm wrong. But that their response was is that that's actually determined by the publishers are saying if you're outside of the service area, you're not allowed to have access to our content. That wasn't Overdrive saying if you fall under this case, we are not going to give you access to that content. Is that relevant to you? Is that what is your response to that?
Well, two things. One, Overdrive agreed to the publisher's terms instead of arguing with it, or instead of involving libraries in the discussion and saying, hey, library, customer people, this is what the publishers are saying. Let's try to find a solution that works for everybody. Overdrive just did what they did. But again, what really, really bothers me is that they put that into place without being open about it, without saying, hey, these publishers have said that if you authenticate patrons such and such a way, you're not going to have access to their materials. So if you're one of those people or libraries that authenticates that way, you want to be really careful to decide, do you want to change how you authenticate so you can have access to everything, or do you want to stay authenticating the way that you do and then have access to this subset of materials? There was no discussion, no openness whatsoever. That's what bothers me.
Okay. All right. So again, kind of for you, it's ultimately transparency.
And honesty, because to me, this was them trying to pull the wool over our eyes. And I know, obviously, companies do this. They're trying to make money. But I don't want to reward that type of behavior with my money.
Okay. All right. Is there anything else you want to say about ebooks?
No, you're getting me all riled up. My heart rate's all up. Dude, I got to go to a staff meeting after this. I'm going to be all
rare. Oh, okay. Well, apologize.
That's okay.
I apologize to your staff. and I think I might be able to calm you down a little bit with a couple of questions and get you, you know, ready for your staff meeting. Scrolling back up here on your blog, your latest post is what Sarah said. What is the story? What is this? What Sarah said here? I mean, people can read that post on the screen, but I'd like to hear the genesis of it from you. What's going on here?
Well, a couple of things. One is that I'm spending a ton of time every day answering questions from people, mostly sent by email, sometimes comments on the site, sometimes just, you know, Twitter messages, but people asking me very specific questions about their library situation or about copyright or whatever. I mean, anything and everything. And I'm spending so much time doing that. And I never don't answer a question because I feel like people are asking for help, and I'm a librarian. I have to give them help. And so all of that time that's been sunk into that is really taken away from right. All of that's really taken away from the time that I've been able to dedicate to blogging. And I'm just not blogging as much because I'm trying to help all these individuals. And so I'm trying to take all those questions now that I'm getting from individual one-on-one questions and just turn them into either blog posts or short video answers or whatever, as a way to not only keep, you know, being able to post but help those people as well, but also as a way to share that information, because I think a lot of what people are asking me is stuff that other people are wondering about too. And I wanted to start a video cast for a long time, and I recorded some test sessions of a few different formats and wasn't real happy with them. And I think this is going to work. I think this will be a good way to combine those things together. So send in your questions, anything and everything, preferably library or technology related, but I'll tackle anything.
There you go. Yeah, and hey, feel free to post this video or audio afterwards. It could be, you know, an inaugural episode or something for you.
Yes.
Well, and I noticed you've been, you know, you're blogging. You've been somebody I've been following and known for several years now through conferences and blogging and various other things. But I've started to notice you popping up in lots of other places. You've been on some Twitch shows lately. The video though I wanted to ask you about is I actually saw a video you were hosting Tom Merritt as an author instead of as a tech journalist on the most intriguing sofa I have ever seen in my life. What is that show? I found just the one video. It's like it was a regular thing.
No, it's not a regular thing.
Okay.
Yeah, so Tom Merritt is a tech journalist that works for Twit and hosts a few different shows on that network. But he's also a San Rafael resident. And he and his wife live like 5 minutes away from me. And, you know, we had started talking, and he had just put out his second book. And I said, dude, do you want to do a book reading for through the library? And he's like, oh, nobody will come. I don't know. But he agreed. And so there's this beautiful mansion just up the hill from the library called the Falkirk Mansion. And it's, you know, this beautiful, you know, 130-year-old gorgeous building, and with original furniture, like the most intriguing sofa that you've ever seen. And that sofa was so uncomfortable.
Oh, okay.
but he decided to bring some Twit folks with him, and they live streamed the reading. And I thought that was awesome. We had something like I think 70 people watching the live stream, and we had about, you know, 20 people at the live event. So for an author reading, that was killer. That worked out really, really well for us. And you know, he had a good time. And yeah, I hope to do more stuff like that where we're able to stream out events from the library.
Yeah, no, I thoroughly enjoyed it. I kind of sat here playing on one of my other screens the other day, and I was like, oh, wow, is this regular? And it should be.
All right. I will make the attempt.
Unfortunately, I'm sorry the sofa is not very comfortable. That's
No, I believe all the springs died about 40 years ago. So it was like sitting on a big puff of air with some metal jutting up into your back end. Yeah,
ah,
it was awesome.
Okay. Gotcha. And the other question I had, and I don't remember where I saw this, but I have a little note here that says Librarian Book Club.
Oh, yeah.
What is this?
We've not met in a couple of months, but there's a little group of us here in the San Francisco Bay Area that are kind of like, I don't know, more nerdy type librarian folk. And so we've been reading non-library, but sort of library-related nonfiction, and then meeting up and having a little book club.
Oh.
And just meeting at somebody's house and talking about what we read in abstract, and then talking about how it might relate to our work in libraries. And it's been totally fun, totally useful, and I'm reading books that normally I would see on the shelf and go, yeah, I should read that, and then I never do. So it's been a good motivation to keep my horizons open.
Yeah, you should see the large pile that's just off to my right here of those books I need to be reading.
And that's, we all have the pile.
And that's just at work. Forget home. Now I'm going to kind of put you on the spot here. Any chance you'd it sounds like a great idea. Any chance of taking it virtual?
Huh. I don't know. I didn't start it. So like, I don't own the rights to this book club. But it would be fun to do that. I mean, that would be easy enough to do through Goodreads or something. Or library thing. yeah, it could be done. I think what I like about the live event, and I mean, I miss virtual, so this says a lot, but
sure.
I like actually being face-to-face and socializing with people from time to time.
Really?
Not all the time. But, you know, occasionally I want that face-to-face interaction. Plus, there's snacks, right? There's snacks,
well,
and you can't really do the snack thing virtually.
And when I suggest taking it virtual, I don't by any means mean to suggest you should stop meeting in person, too. I mean, you know, you could just kind of expand the group, and y'all can still have your little core group. You know, and I don't know. It sounds like a good idea, and I don't have the time to set it up. So
I was just going to say there should be like little local chapters of this little mini library.
Yeah, that would work. All right. Okay, and then my kind of last question for you, this will kind of put you on the spot because I did not mention this at the time. I thought of it as I was setting this up. Is there any cool service, tool, website, something that like you found recently that you think everybody else should know about that now's kind of your opportunity to say, yeah, I've been playing with X and it's really cool?
Let me see if I can find it. There is something. I found this as a comment on someone else's Facebook status. And so it was, this person was saying that he was having writer's block and was having a hard time motivating himself to write. And I gave like some very stupid practical suggestions, like, you know, just try writing something, anything, and get up and take a walk and move around and then you'll feel better. Someone else suggested this website called Written Kitten. So it's writtenkitten.net. And what's neat is that you can set a parameter of words, and every time you write X number of words, it shows you a new picture of a kitten. And so you're rewarded by cuteness the more you write. And I've tried it a couple of times now, and I'm so sad to say it actually works for me. It's actually a motivator to keep writing. And I feel very shallow and stupid, and like, you know, the gamification of seeing a little pussycat just because I wrote a few words shouldn't make me as happy as it does. But this was my new favorite thing, I think.
And I just pasted in some text I pulled up off of a web page that happened to be in my other browser, and yeah, it works.
Now, look at that little baby. Doesn't that make you happy? And then you write some more, and then you get another one.
Oh, jeez. I have two book projects going. I'm not sure this would completely help me, but all right. That's wow. Okay. Hey, I asked and I got an answer.
You did.
Wow. All right. Is there anything else while I've got you on the line you'd like to share or tell us or do we end on kittens? I usually have a couple of links I like to share with folks once the conversation is over. And for those of you looking at the video, I'm sorry, the sun is coming through my window in a weird way at the moment.
No, I think ending on kittens is the exact right way to do any library interview.
That works. Especially knowing you. Okay, I'm just going to stop there. Sarah, I want to thank you so much. This has been wonderful. This is one of those situations where I ask somebody to do this, and they're like, what are we going to talk about for, you know, an hour? And we've pretty much filled the hour without even trying very hard.
Thanks, Michael.
So always wonderful to talk to you. You're welcome to stay on the line. I'm going to just put you back on mute. And for regular listeners here, as you know, I try to sneak in just a couple of things at the end. It's the end of the year. It's really slow. There's not a lot going on, but I am going to just pull up a couple of links. I will add Written Kitten to the bookmarks for this archive session here. But I just, again, want to share just a couple of other things. One is, speaking of copyright issues, something you may want to be aware of if you are one of those folks who uses something called BitTorrent. There is this service out here called haveyoudownloaded.com. And if you're downloading material online that may not be something completely legal to download, it may not be as difficult as you think to figure out that you're actually downloading that. And what this site does is it takes a look at the IP address that you are currently using, and it will tell you if this particular site has any records of you downloading any of that content. Now, does it mean what you're doing is illegal? Does it mean what you're doing is legal? If it doesn't find you, that doesn't mean somebody else couldn't. I just find it's as somebody who does use BitTorrent for downloading certain things, Linux distributions, for example, it is kind of an intriguing site, privacy, copyright issues, that sort of thing. You might want to take a look at that if you are a BitTorrent user. The next one I want to show you is, this is a Twitter account, real-time WWII, or live tweets from World War II. This is somebody who is kind of tweeting as if it was today, but in 1939, And then for the next 6 years, they plan on continuing this. So the idea is that you follow this Twitter stream and you can, via Twitter, kind of relive the experience of World War II and the history of that kind of as it happened or now as it happens. If nothing else, if you're a history buff, an interesting feed, World War II buff, or if you're just looking for kind of non-standard but very intriguing and, dare I say, educational uses for Twitter, this might be an account you would want to check out and to follow. And then the last one here, this one I bookmarked quite a while ago. I don't remember what it actually does. Post. This is a way where you can search for content from your social feeds, but it's going to be a little more organized by kind of multimedia content. So instead of just following text, you can see, just show me the pictures from the different services I follow, or just show me the videos from the different services I follow from the people that I follow. And in this case, I would need to sign in to actually get some results here. But considering that some of those folks that I follow probably don't necessarily want to make their content public, I will just talk about it and not actually show all of that material for the recording. The last thing, I'm just going to throw this in here because we've got the time. Excuse me, I'm going to go off camera for just a second. We just got a new toy at the commission. To start with, here is my phone. So if this gives you an idea here, it is a Droid Bionic. Then I show you this little box here, which is actually a little thicker, but actually smaller than my phone. This is what's called a Pico Pocket Projector. This is actually something you can plug into your laptop or your phone, and it actually will project the screen onto the wall. We literally just got this thing yesterday. They list for about $300. We found a refurbished unit for only $110. So something that I'll be playing with in upcoming presentations and whatnot. But I mean, this thing is small. It's a little taller and not much thicker than I would say a box of cigarettes, and seems to work very well on very early tests. So if you're looking for kind of an ultra portable lightweight projector, this might be something you'd want to take a look at. They're called Pico projectors. This one happens to be from a company called Optima. So just a little bit of hardware to show you there. In fact, probably can see it better over on this side with the whiteboard there. So that's pretty much it for Tech Talk this week and this month. I want to thank Sarah once again for attending, for participating, and for all of you for attending. Krista will be back next week with our regular NCompass Lives, and we've got some interesting shows coming up. I will say we already have kind of a plan for Tech Talk for January. We're going to have a couple of guests on, and we're going to be talking about technology and things dealing with giving presentations, you know, how to hook up your laptop to a projector. Speaking of projectors, might bring up the Pico projector again that time. Some advice for dealing with tech when it comes to presentations, that sort of thing. So I encourage all of you to attend. We have recorded this session. Audio and video recordings will be available usually within about 24 to 48 hours of the actual recording. And so I'm going to say thank you to everybody for attending. Thank you once again to Sarah for participating. And we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.